Like, we call them Tesla coils.
Why? Okay.
What? Because they're energy, like pulsating electricity. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Filipino Freethinkers podcast. That's also a video. I'm Red.
I'm Talia.
And today we're talking about beauty, the standards of beauty, particularly the ones used by the Binibining Pilipinas beauty pageant.
And that's why we have Red here, because he's won multiple times.
I have won multiple times.
Right.
And obviously, yeah, there's a reason that we are the ones who are on this particular podcast.
I'm always the judge. He's okay. Always the winner, you know,
okay.
Obviously.
All kidding aside, though, let's get into it. The topic is, of course, you know, the impetus for this discussion is this particular photo that, you know, that shows Senator Sunny Angara sharing on Instagram.
Stop it.
An image of the criteria used. So let's read through it. Criteria, beauty of face.
Face.
50% beauty of figure.
30%.
30% intelligence.
Intelligence, I'm 10%.
Poise and personality.
Garrick over there is
10%. 10%. So, you know, like, okay, which of these 10% is poise and which is personality, you know? Like,
how? I think they get 5% each.
Okay, so what were
considering considering their math, 6% each.
Okay. What do you think were the reactions to this photo? Like, on like when I shared this, like, some people were saying, like, why is it just beauty that they use as a criteria, you know? Like, you know, stuff like that you can expect. What did you see?
Well, I saw a couple of the articles that were talking about this, and a lot of the comments were saying, how naive can you be? I mean, I'm sure that we all knew that beauty would be this, like, this and that and this and that.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there were still the hopeful, probably 13-year-olds who were saying, no, I thought that my intelligence would matter if I joined a beauty contest.
It does matter. Like, 10% of it is intelligence.
Yes.
But, you know, like you already mentioned it, on the face of it, it is a beauty pageant. You know, you call it a beauty pageant and not an intelligence pageant or a quiz bee.
Yes, they say it's not a spelling bee or a quiz
bee. You know, or not an ethics contest. You know, it's beauty that's being measured here. And is that a bad thing? Like, you know, let's get into that. Is this a bad thing, do you think? Would you say that it's detrimental?
It depends. I mean, there are so many things to take into consideration on this. I mean, there's the fact that kids, women, girls nowadays, their self-esteem's just shot, all that. And then there's also the fact that it is a beauty contest. We have other competitions for intelligence. We have the Price is Right is not for intelligence.
Okay, we have Jeopardy.
Yes,
you know,
that's
for
what it's going for.
All of those other trivia shows. You know, these other contests do put more premium on what your mind contains rather than what your outside appearance looks like, right?
Yes.
But given that it does cause body image issues to a lot of people, it sets up that standard of beauty that is very Hollywood, you know, very much set by Hollywood. You know, you have to be thin.
High cheekbones, pretty eyes.
You have to have
lips.
That space between
your thigh gap.
You know, the thigh gap that people edit using Photoshop onto those model images.
It's only like it's the crotch and then 5 inches of space.
And then young women who aren't exactly like that, and they see these pictures and they feel bad and it makes them want to kill themselves, you know, in the worst of cases. And sometimes, I don't doubt that sometimes they do.
Sure.
A lot of people are depressed by it. You know, they get cosmetic surgery, they work
diet,
out too much, or, you know,
anorexia,
go on unhealthy diets. And all because they think that beauty is such an important thing. But is it really such an important thing? I mean, these people who say that beauty is not so important, like, I wonder how much they really value beauty. I mean, do they, like, consciously try to avoid making that the main criteria when they choose a potential mate? I mean, we're going to talk about this during the next meetup, and it's going to be interesting what the people who disagree with this criteria actually use themselves, you know, when they look for their romantic partners. Like, let's test you, for instance. Like, okay, what is your criteria? And if you're, you know, listening to this podcast or watching it, feel free to put in the comments the criteria that you use for choosing a potential mate. So rate it, okay? Like,
I don't really ask for much. I only ask for one thing. It's just perfection. You know, it's not
okay,
that
perfection,
much,
100%.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, okay. You know, all kidding aside, beauty of face, beauty of figure, you know, if you had to put percentages on these things, you know, there's not even an attitude here.
There's not even a sense of humor.
Yeah, because, you know, what are you going to do? Like, have a stand-up, like...
Hey, why not?
Maybe, you know, for some formats that might work. Okay, let's get to it. Beauty of face, how much would you, you know, put on there?
I'm not sure. It depends. Am I stuck with these four criteria?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, God damn it. I guess I'd give beauty of face maybe 20.
Wow, see, okay, 20%. Beauty of figure?
Maybe 25.
25, so 50% is the outward appearance, I suppose.
45. That's 45, okay. Guys. I can math. Yes.
And intelligence.
I'm guessing 35 goes into intelligence, 20 goes to poison personality. 12 and 8, respectively.
Okay, so you gave intelligence the highest.
Because I'm assuming that intelligence also has their sense of humor in it.
Okay.
So, yes.
Okay, and I'm going to be honest here. My criteria is 50% beauty of face, 50% beauty of figure, 50% intelligence, and 50% poison personality. So I give equal value, and I suppose this is what the critics of this kind
of—they don't get 25% each. No, they get 50.
I mean, they're just as important. So, you know, 200%. I always tell my potential romantic partners, give it 200% if you really want a relationship. But, you know, okay, all seriousness, this is not far from what I would expect. I would say that, you know, at least 50% would be on attractiveness. And Dan Ariely, he studied, you know, he wrote the books Upside of Irrationality, you know, books like these. And one of the things that the studies revealed was that people, like everyone, you know, no matter how much of a feminist or social justice advocate you are, you value attractiveness or beauty in a romantic partner just about as much as you think you yourself have that attribute. Let's say I think that I'm an 8 on the attractiveness scale. I would rate attractiveness, the importance of attractiveness in a romantic partner, as an 8 as well. And we did this in a meetup. We asked everyone the same question, like, how would you rate yourself in terms of attractiveness? How important would you say attractiveness is to you when you look for a romantic partner? We asked everyone, and they gave a variety of answers. We got, you know, a range of 2s to 10s. You know, we got 5s and 6s. And it always turns out that the number that they give for the first question is around, you know, by 1 point, or a lot of times they're the same number, the same as what they give for the first question. So let's say you, like, how would you rate yourself? And you as well, like, you know, the people watching this, think about that, reflect on that. What would your answers be? What would your answers be?
I guess I'm about a 5 or a 6.
Wow, okay, 5, that's high, yeah? Wow,
I know.
The confidence. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
and I'm how very much, confident.
And how much would you say attractiveness rates on your criteria for romantic relationships?
Romantic relationships. Just romantic relationships.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just romantic. You know, that significant other. That ho-hol partner. or more than ho-hol, you know.
Regardless of what my mother thinks. Because my mother's very vain.
Okay, yeah. You know, are you watching this, Miss Ruiz?
Hi, mother. Oh. Remember all the times you immediately said, no, he's ugly? Yes, this.
Okay. So,
If my mom had an opinion on it, or if she were to see, it'd have to be about a 9.
Okay, but if it's just you, you know, I don't think your mom is watching this, but
she probably is.
Okay, if she is, okay.
My mom.
What is your?
I guess a 7.
7. So just around as much as, you know, so roughly. So there's the thing. So when people say that all these people who think that attractiveness isn't so important, that they're just ugly, I don't know, it's politically incorrect. Is it politically incorrect to think that there's some truth to that? Because that's what Dan Ariely's study, you know, kind of implies. You know, if you don't have attractiveness, you don't think it's as important. And if you do have a, you know, if you think you are attractive, you know, it's of course very subjective. These are self-reports. If you do think you are attractive, then you think attractiveness is important. Mm-hmm. Beauty pageants, yes. Like we touched on it earlier. There are pageants or contests for things like intellect.
Yes.
Or if they're not outright contests, there are arenas for yes. all of these other, you know, there's not even a criteria here for physicality, you know. We have sports yes. like basketball, you know, like, and in basketball, it doesn't really matter how much of a sportsman you are. You know, like at the end of the day, it's the scores, the amount of hoops, you know, the three-pointers, two-pointers, or free throws that you make that determine who wins or loses, and your sportsmanship counts for nothing, really. You know, that kind of saying about it's not whether you win or lose.
It's how you play the game.
It's how you play the game. That doesn't count, and it's that's for basketball. When it comes to writing, you know, especially for writing for science,
yes.
you know, for these peer-reviewed journals, it doesn't matter how poetic you are, you know, how much the ends of your sentences rhyme. It's whether it's true or not, you know, whether it's verifiable, you know, if it's good science that you're doing. Of course, I know, there are exceptions to that, obviously. Yes. But ideally, you know, you rate the intelligence. I mean, it's intelligence that matters in these scenes. And and I can imagine how sports could make people feel inferior as well. You know, there are these people who are so muscular. I mean, I'm such a thin and inadequate person.
Inadequate. And
I mean, compared to all of these gigantic and, you know, David figures that even better than David. But anyway, like they can jump so high, they can dunk and all that, and that could make people inferior as well. And these excellent writers and thinkers, when they use this perfect grammar and they have all of these literary references that they pepper their compositions with, and I haven't read half of the books that they have, it also makes me and a lot of other writers, you know, it gives us procrastination and perfectionism that we can't
reach. Is that a fair comparison, though? I mean,
is it?
Look at beauty pageants. Again, yeah. 50% goes to your face.
Uh-huh.
It's not like that's something you can fix without a lot of money. Your bone structure is what you're born with.
Yeah.
It comes from your genes. I mean, it's not your fault if you're the fifth generation crooked-eyed,
okay.
bumpy-nosed person.
Are you saying being crooked-eyed or being bumpy-nosed is a negative thing? We're politically correct here at Philippine.
It's not that. It's just okay. That comparing that to what we usually see in beauty pageants. They usually have very high cheekbones,
okay.
perfect skin, weirdly beautiful eyes,
yeah.
and really cutesy little chins and,
yeah. So those
lips.
Okay.
I mean, if you don't have these traits, which are usually something you're born with or injected, it's just not something you can really easily fix. But reading, you can read up, you can, you know, put an effort to jump higher, just run more and all these things. I don't know if that's something you can compare.
That's a very good point that you raised there. And I think that's what a lot of people do think. Like these people who join the beauty pageants, they're just born with these things. They didn't work hard at it, right?
Yeah.
But I think that even that is a misconception. Like people, these people who join beauty pageants, they do work out like so much every day. And, you know, the amount of discipline that they have in their diets, you know?
Yes, I do understand that. But that goes into the beauty of figure.
Mm.
I was talking entirely about the beauty of face, which gets 50%.
Like you mean the
your bone structure,
the genetics.
The color of your eyes, the color of your hair.
Yeah.
And it's these things that you can't really change much. Plus the fact that beauty pageants, they have a height discrimination thing.
That's
you
true.
You have to be
that's
at the very
true.
Least 5'7".
That's
I'm surprised
true.
That women in the Philippines make it.
So, you know, there are some of these things that outright prevent people from joining.
Exactly.
And I think that goes with the same as sports. or writing, you know, journal, scientific journal articles. Let's start with sports. There isn't really a height requirement. You know, you can be 5'3", you know, but if you're not Muggsy Bogues, you know, who did manage to join the NBA despite his small figure. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're not him, like, do you think you can really compete at the level of these 6'6", you know, 7-foot people? I mean, it's there. The constraints are there, and that's just something that you're born with or you're not. Let's talk about like journal articles. Like, you think that people worked hard to be as smart as they are. It also an accident of birth that, you know, you happen to be born to parents who can send you to Harvard or you know, if it's law that you're writing about, or some other popular school, you know, that can give you what you need to excel at the sciences. You know, these things are also as much of an accident, I think, as genetics is, you know?
I don't think that they're at the same level yet.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're doing so much more to make it easier for people to educate themselves at the same level, to train themselves at the same level.
Yeah.
But your bone structure isn't as easy to change. The things you were genetically born with, your height is even harder to change.
And one could argue that the circumstances of your birth, you know, how poor you are, where you're sent to school, or whether you're even sent to school, is equally or is even more difficult to change. You know, but whether these things are comparable or, you know, if it's a fair analogy, we will discuss this at the next meetup, which is happening April 13, I think.
Yes.
April 13, if I'm not mistaken. And I wish that you could be there. You know, you could. We will talk about these criteria of beauty, whether beauty pageants are just as unfair as sports or science
writing.
Yeah. But till the next podcast, thank you for watching. Thank you.
Thank you.
And see you next time.